So we'll talk about, I mean, when we see what are the sensor characteristics that are required for an application and how to go about selecting a sensor and or actuator, I mean, for example. I mean, both are similar, having similar requirements. Okay. Now, these are basic formulations like the charge generated is proportional to some force applied, okay, and where this D is a piezoelectric coefficient. And okay, this is like a static relationship. I am not considering here dynamic relationship, okay. So in dynamics, like you will have more complicated, there is a effect of capacitance also coming into picture in the constitutive basic fundamental relations for the piezoelectric sensor. So this is a static relationship, and then in that we see that this voltage is proportional to the force, okay. Then basic materials that are there for piezoelectricity are quartz crystal, then PZT like lead zirconium titanate and PVDF, okay. Now out of these, maybe like some of the materials like which are compatible with the MEMS processes, I mean, they are basically used for, see, these piezoelectric sensors, they are actuators also, okay. So sensing and actuation is combined in this. Piezoelectric effect is reversible, okay. It's not just sensing, but like now if you apply voltage, there will be a force produced. So you can make use of this unique feature. There is a trick. Maybe I can talk at a little later point. When I talk about actuators, I mean it will be better. I should talk it about that time, because basically you can use the actuation and sensing together, okay, and have the capabilities of your sensor enhanced, okay. So say for example, if you have a accelerometer which is sensing some range of acceleration, you can have additional voltage, I mean whatever principle based on which it is working, like you can have additional actuation inside the sensor itself, okay, which can enhance, like if you give some bias, okay, now the range of acceleration, say for example 1g to 3g it was measuring previously, then with the bias you can change that range to measure with 1 to 3, I mean like 3g change only, but you can have that at 10g to 13g, okay. So that is possible with if you have sensor and actuator together. I mean that philosophy, I mean not many people have exploited that so far. I mean we'll talk about when we come to MEMS, like where it is very easily exploitable, okay. So that is also possibility, okay. So if you want a sensor which can perform very very good and also have higher range, okay, see there is a dilemma here, okay. When you demand more range, okay, your sensing accuracy typically will go down, okay. That is, you take any sensor specification and you see the any sensor data sheets and you see the range, if they have the enhanced range of sensing, their accuracy has to go down. I mean that is a way, like I mean all the things in the nature behave. So its resolution will go down, okay. But if you want to have both at the same time, okay, you can use, I mean there again you can have a sensor itself as a mechatronic system where you have actuation inside the sensor, okay. That is very very nice way of doing like a high performance thing using mechatronics, okay, and in the same cost, okay. When you demand high resolution and high range both at the same time, you will typically find in the current data sheets in the literature, like you will find that sensor will be very costly, okay. So higher range and higher resolution both at the same time, the sensor will be costly, and that cost you can bring down by using mechatronics philosophy in there, okay. If you don't understand point, I mean this is like a important point for futuristic sensors, okay. Now this is one of the application of piezoelectric sensor for the sensing pressure in the mold cavity. Advantage basically is again as I was talking about, both actuation and sensing is possible, and they are typically high frequency kind of sensors. Okay, so very high dynamics they can sense, like okay. Okay, now let us come to the sensor selection. Okay, so based on like okay, you have some conceptualized some idea about your mechatronic system, and you have come now to the level. Okay, I want to sense variable. Okay, you know the variable that you want to sense, and there are many possibilities. Like for displacement sensing, you can have encoder, or I mean, there are tons of possibilities there. So what is to be selected? So basically, you come up first with the sensor requirements. Okay, what exactly will suffice your job? Okay, you should not have something which is overkill, and at the same time something which will not work. Okay, there are these two extremes. Like okay, either you have something which is overkill. Like okay, you say okay, you don't do detailed analysis, and then okay, you come up with something, some specification, you know for sure it will work. But I mean, you see into detail, like okay, whether it is overkill for my system. Okay, so it should not be that overkill, and it should also work. Okay, it should not be that it is not working, I mean. Okay, so that for that you need to do some system analysis, system modeling. Okay, and then like come up with system requirements, and from system requirements derive the sensor requirements. Okay, that is a formal way of like getting to the sensor. Okay, of course there will be, as we do in the mechanical domain, like your first iteration, then second iteration of design, like that, there will be some iterations. Okay, you may have to go through, like okay, you select something, and then you go and analyze your mechatronics, like I mean the interfacing, and you say that okay this is not working for this particular, let me change this, and so that kind of a thing always you need to do. Okay, but that is a design is a iterative process. I mean that's but your analysis and your knowledge of mechatronics will decrease the number of iterations that you have to go through. Okay, so analysis you basically do depending upon your application frequency. Okay, do you understand what is application frequency? Like application bandwidth. Okay, where which frequency your thing is like operating at. Okay, your device is operating at. Okay, if it is like okay, say for example this liquid level sensor, okay, that we'll take it as a example. And if I'm just interested in change, like monitoring the level of a liquid, okay, not these dynamic changes in the level, okay, just like simple level, that is very slowly changing level in for example in the overhead tanks. Okay, that is very slowly changing, so there I don't need to bother about like dynamic bandwidth. Okay, it's very slowly, like say for example if the liquid level in my tank changes, and I get to see that only after say whatever, because of whatever like the response time of a sensor, I get to see only after 2 seconds, it's okay, right? Well, I'm not interested in like okay monitoring the liquid changes in my overhead tank, I mean second to second. Okay, but the same thing if I'm going for the slosh application, where I'm interested in knowing like how the liquid level is changing because of the motion of the tank, then it is a different matter. I cannot use that. Okay, so you understand the difference. Okay, so you need to see what are the end goals that your system is supposed to work for. Okay, and accordingly you come up with bandwidth and like amplitude range requirements for your sensor. Okay, and then once you know the analysis, and at least rough analysis, and you are clear about some of the numbers, then like it's a matter of just going to the data sheets and selecting okay, this is appropriate, this is not appropriate, like that. Okay, then based on the analog and digital sensor, you need to worry about the noise in the system. Okay, this is very important practical point. Okay, I mean, theoretically, everything is sound, okay, you have a linear sensor and all those things you say, but when you practically connect the wires, I mean, every wire is sitting there to act as an antenna, okay. I mean, believe me, it's very important to think ahead of time, like how, what is the way you are going to connect, how much is the length of wire that you are going to use, and what is the magnetic field or electromagnetic sources around your application, okay. Say for example, typically this is a case like all the mechatronics engineers, they will go for some motor, there will be some motor in the, and for motor you need a motor driver, okay, high power motor is there, there is a high power driver, and typically all these drivers, they are based on the something called edge bridge configuration. Let us see, I mean, I have that in the slides, but I don't know whether I'll get a time to talk about it in detail, but the, in those edge bridge, there is high frequency switching that is happening. See, any high voltage switching will cause electromagnetic disturbance, okay. Say for example, here in the tubelets, you have a choke, okay, where there is a high frequency thing going on. High frequency and high electromagnetic that choke coils are really heavy, okay. So high voltage electromagnetics is there. Similarly, like if you go for motor controller, I mean edge bridge controller, I mean they'll have this kind of a switching going on there. So wherever that acts as a source of noise to your sensors. And your sensor sitting in a electro or mechatronic kind of a application by the side of this kind of a source is really damaging, okay. And actually we have seen in our application of this Losch rig a lot of noise, okay. We are using the pressure, I mean not pressure, the force sensor, 6-axis load cell, okay. And it used to give a lot of noise. Then we'll have to think about, okay, what are the strategies we'll eliminate this noise, and if not eliminate completely, like what we can do to at least software process that thing so that like we get the signal which is of interest, okay. So signal processing consideration, I don't know whether they are getting covered in this course, but they are again important in this sense, okay. Okay, then the cost implications, as I was saying, you have to balance against like okay, what is the cost that your company is permitting you, okay, to spend, okay. And you may be recommending, okay, that within whatever this much cost, it is not at all possible, or this is overkill, I mean you don't need really that higher cost, I mean you can save on the cost, all those kinds of things, like if you do proper analysis, what are the requirements, then you can come up with the numbers. Okay, for, yeah. I'm talking about specifically for robotic applications there, okay. See, for robotics, like first you need to do kinematic analysis, okay, then only you can go for dynamic analysis. Basically, this kinematic I have mentioned for the robotics application. What you need to do is basically a dynamic analysis, okay. Okay. That's what I was telling when I consider the example of Slosh. Okay, when you are interested in monitoring the liquid level in the overhead tank, you don't have to consider the dynamics, okay, and because it is changing very slowly over the day. But in my Slosh application, like I'll show you video, the liquid is changing its level very fast and having various kinds of ways in which it is sloshing, and I want to study those ways of sloshing. If that is my end goal, I need to have a sensor which can respond faster than that application, whatever the changes are happening.
So how is the dynamic analysis done?
Oh, how is the dynamic analysis done? You need to go to this next step, which is mathematical modeling of a system. Okay, this you have to mathematically capture the dynamics. Okay, say for example, this Losch application. Okay. I can just consider it to be a pendulum kind of a system, simple pendulum kind of a system, and study the dynamics, Okay, though it is a complex application, I mean, where a lot of fluid motion and fluid structure interaction is involved, like one of the ways, okay, depending upon the frequency, of course, but like whatever, this kind of a slosh, I can study by using pendulum analogy. Okay, so like that, you need to think about, okay, even an application, what is the way I can come up with the mathematical model? Okay, once you come up with the mathematical model, then like you analyze that. See, it should be a reasonably representing your phenomena that is happening. Like say, for example, one of the students in our mechatronics course, like he was studying, I mean, he was studying the dynamics of motor, and he asked me a question, sir, why we should not take a air damping when the motor is rotating? Okay, so the thing is that, see, these are all the phenomena that are definitely happening, okay, but are they relevant for my process? Are they affecting my process? Okay, see, motor is rotating, air which is surrounding the motor, how fast it is damping? If you compare the damping in the bearings and damping of the air which is rotating, I mean, which is like moving around, I mean, because of the shaft rotation, it's big gap. It's hardly, I mean, it's negligible. You can safely, I mean, very safely ignore that. Okay, so you, I mean, that quality is there with all of us engineers. Okay, that, okay, seeing the phenomena, observing the phenomena very carefully, you need to think about, okay, whether what is important, what is not important to model. Okay, see, you cannot say that there is a perfect mathematical model for any phenomena in the world. There will be no perfect model. All models, whether it is linear or nonlinear, there will be approximations. Okay, approximations that you are specifying, okay, in this range, that application will be, application range, that approximation will be valid. Okay, so that is very, very important point to take home. That you need to be able to see, okay, and we have, all of engineers have that quality, okay, to some extent. We need to be conscious about it and develop that, okay, but we have that quality that, okay, seeing the phenomena, we know, okay, what is going to be important in this phenomena, okay. Now to translate that in the mathematics is a skill that we need to like develop and master, okay. Once we develop that skill, then whatever this, like how to come up with the dynamic requirements of a sensor will be very easy. Okay, so modeling of the phenomena, okay, under consideration with a simple mathematical model which is representing like most of the essence of the application, that is a key. Okay. Case study, I'll see what time permits. Like, I mean, I'm already running late, but let us see.
And sometimes unnecessary. Like slow sensor, I can visualize like this. It's a car petrol tank running on a very bad road.
Yeah. You don't need
large variation in this level.
So
you see the level sensor, it's basically highly damped.
Exactly. Yeah. That's very right.
In volume, I need at least three sensors to find out the first of all the plane of the movement and the response time of that. How fast is it going to move? You cannot visualize this even. When car is running on a very
So you'll not be able to judge what is the level, because like in car, when the liquid is moving or in the petrol tank your fuel is moving, and if you have very high response time sensor placed in there, it will always be fluctuating. Okay, it will not show you what is actual level. I mean, so you have to do something to like have this response time damped or like. Exactly. Yeah, that's a good example. Okay, so once this mathematical model is there and you do the analysis, little bit of analysis, dynamic analysis, use MATLAB to carry out simulation, and then you can come up with proper specifications, and then like you can use them with the manufacturer's catalog to select a particular sensor for your application. Okay, so that is about That is all about sensors. Now we will focus on actuators now. Okay, some of the basic principles and things are similar. I mean, say for example, selection of actuators. I mean, again, there you need to worry about bandwidth and how fast you want to have the dynamics going and things like that. Okay, so I will not spend the time on that, but I will give you the flavor of typical actuators that are used in the mechatronic system. Okay, AC and DC motors, stepper motors and hydraulic actuators are three major classes, okay, that are used for mechatronic system. And solenoids, of course, I mean they are not kind of a servo actuators, okay. They are like a, I mean, 0-1 kind of a actuators, okay. So piezoelectric motors and other pneumatic devices we will not talk about, but they can also be used in mechatronic system. Pneumatic devices mainly you will find go well with the PLC kind of a controller, okay. How many of you are working with you are working with PLC? So there it is kind of a logic which is very easy to be programmed, and then like you have this kind of actuators, pneumatic actuators working there quite well. Okay, so DC motors, the basic principle is wire carrying conductor placed in magnetic field will generate a force when so that force is basically used for like moving and generating like whatever, like this rotary motion in the motor or whatever. Okay, so there are two primary classes. One is brush type DC motor and another is brushless type. So brushless DC motors, because of obvious reasons like there is no friction in the brush to like reduce the speed. I mean, we can have these motors going at very high speeds. Okay, and then you can have also AC, similar kind of AC motors also. Wide variety of motors are available in the market, okay. So I'll not get into the details about these, but there are the main thing that you need to look for is whether the torque or whatever torque and speeds are compatible for your application and whatever say actuator you are selecting, okay. That is again based on that actuator. Similar to the sensor selection, you have to do this analysis and come up with the actuator specifications. Okay. Solid state switching is basically you use the semiconductor. Okay. There is no physical switch. Okay. Yeah, transistor switching, which is solid state. Okay, so stepper motors are basically used for high torque and low speed kind of application. Okay, we'll see exactly how the stepper motor works. I mean, the principle and other thing. There is a stepping action, as the name suggests, in the motor. Okay, so it's not like a smoothly running. I mean, okay, of course, this smoothness will depend upon what is required for the application. But typically the stepper motor, if you are filling, like you rotate the shaft of the stepper motor, you will not be able to rotate it smoothly. It will go in and lock into some steps. Okay, so that is the way the stepper motor is designed to work actually. This is ideal for implementation of digital control. So why, it will become clear in the next slide. Also, there is a holding torque in the stepper motor. Even if you have no power given to the stepper motor, it has some holding torque, okay, which may be important for some applications. Okay, so that you can make use of. Then there are various types of constructions and configurations possible, and these are the two different types of stepper motors. But basic principle is like this: you have a permanent magnet, which is here, and these coils surrounding it can be like excited in pulses. Okay, so say for example, when you excite one of the coils, okay, the magnet orientation will change in that direction. Okay, So that is a basic principle of stepper motor. Okay, I am exaggerating it here, like it is not really just 90 degree step at a time, it's 1.8 degree step usually for many of the stepper motors. Okay, so that is like it's very small steps it can move. Okay, so your job, I mean, as a mechatronic engineer is to make sure that okay, this excitation sequence is proper. Okay, so there are many different kinds of sequences also possible for the stepper motor. Say for example, in this particular sequence, you can say this is a half step mode. Okay, you are exciting two coils at a time and one coil in the next insert, I mean next step. Okay, so these logically can be displayed as in here. Okay, so this is a half step sequence. You can see these two coils are excited at a time, and in the next step only one coil is excited. Okay, then the next coil is excited in the next step. Okay, so this logic sequence you need to develop in your microprocessor. Okay, did you see yesterday digital input outputs? No. Okay, but okay. So in microprocessor it is possible to configure or like to program the pins of your digital. There are pins that are provided, like maybe 16 pins or 8 pins will be provided for digital input outputs. Okay, these pins you can program to give either 0 or 1. So you can program this, like say for example in this case you will require these 4 pins. Okay, 1A, 1B, 2A and 2B, there are 4 coils to be excited. So you need 4 pins that you will program there, and on that pin 0 and 1 you give according to this sequence and your motor will start running. Okay, so these are the various applications of stepper motors in your dot matrix printer. So see, these are the sources, like say if you are in the college and you want like for your students to gain knowledge in mechatronics, these are the sources: CD-ROM drive, printer, floppy drives are the sources from where you can, like some gone floppy drive you can collect and then like you can show them, okay, this is a stepper motor. You can so that is just like directly available at no cost, that electronics is available for you. So you can make use of that and demonstrate students to like what are the like sophisticated mechatronics you can demonstrate at no cost at all. Okay, so CD-ROM drive, stepper motor, for example, we have developed one setup around a CD-ROM drive to teach principles of CD-ROM. Okay, and it has all the necessary things. I mean, we have the laser of CD-ROM drive actuated separately, not as in a CD-ROM drive. Okay, we just take a head and then like actuate the laser, and you can see now all the focusing signals and the tracking signals and all those things. Okay, so that is a way. I mean, if you are a college teacher, you can, or in your industry also, I mean, you can think about what can be used, because this is a high quality electronics, believe me. Like anything you take out from the printer or floppy drive or whatever, scanner or whatever, is very high quality electronics that is available at no cost, very low cost. So if your like requirements and that match, you as well borrow it from the existing high quality industrial product. Okay, the question is between DC and stepper, okay, which one is more controllable? That will be told to you by your application. Okay, more controllable is not really. I would say, what are the specifications that you are looking for? The stepper motor technology has like really developed in the years, and people are using stepper motor also in the floppy drives. Okay, of course they are not using it for hard disk drive or like Okay, so that kind of a precision, whatever is required for floppy drive is possible with the stepper motor, but it should be high end rate stepper motor. But typically stepper motors are not used for very high resolution kind of application, typically. Okay, so this is just industrial hydraulic motor. You can see this is a actual motor there on the top here. You can see actual piston motor with a swash plate and other thing, and then that is driving this industrial product. Okay, this is a use of hydraulic devices. I mean, anywhere you see earth moving machinery, okay, you need to have hydraulics there, okay, because you need typically very high forces, high power, okay, and in the mobile application, it can be generated very easily by using pumps, oil pressure, basically, and use that for hydraulic actuators. Okay, now that. So basically how now the way is, okay, we have selected actuator and sensor. Now what are the different interfaces possible for interfacing them with your microcontroller? Okay, this cannot be done independent of microcontroller selection. I mean, I'm not talking right now of microcontroller selection or microprocessor selection, but I'm talking about interfaces. Okay, so you need to make sure that, okay, your microprocessor is having those interfaces or appropriate interfaces for your application. Okay, and okay, there are if you are using microprocessor, then these interfaces you will have to create, okay, based on like some chips which are used for input output ports, for example. 8255 chip, for example, can be interfaced for digital input outputs. So like that, you need to create those. Okay. Another solution, if you are not really in the electronic engineer and you don't want to mess up with electronics, like you can directly go for microcontroller. Okay. Microcontroller are the chips that provide these interfaces to you directly. Okay. If you are working in a research kind of a environment, like it's not a product which is but you are the product is in development, okay, then instead of going for microprocessors or microcontrollers, you can go for data acquisition systems directly, which can be sitting in your computer and controlling your application. Okay, they'll have their own microcontroller, microprocessor on board, but you won't bother about like programming details of that microprocessor. Okay, so there are various kinds of microprocessor interfaces or digital control implementation interfaces possible. I'm not going into details of that. I'm just talking what are the sensors and actuator interfaces. And typically, you see this is a configuration that I have shown here, that your control computation will take place. There'll be clock which will be synchronizing all these events. Like you have analog to digital converter here, which will be taking your sensor. I'm just showing this analog to digital for convenience. Okay, this can be an encoder interface also. I mean, completely digital interface also. But there will be some interface from the sensor, which will interface your sensor with the controller, computer or microprocessor or whatever. Okay, it may be simply. If it is in analog domain, like it may be simply the electronic circuit. Okay, so you have many possibilities in all of these elements. Okay, then from control, you do control computation, and then like you need to give it to your actuator, which is typically in the analog domain. Say for example, your servo motor. Okay, stepper motor is a special case, which is in the digital domain, you can say. But typically, all the other actuators will be in the servo mode, and you'll have them as analog actuators. Okay, so it's required to convert that digital signal into analog domain, and that is done by this digital analog converter. Okay, which can be interfaced with your microprocessor. So, microprocessor. Okay, yesterday you saw the fundamentals of microprocessor, but just microprocessor is not sufficient. You need to have these like peripheral interfaces. Okay, so it's like just the computer chip 486 or Pentium chip you are given. That is not sufficient for you to work. I mean, there should be some interface where you can be seeing what is going on in the chip on the monitor. Okay, so you need that kind of a monitor interface. So this is a similar thing. Okay, just this microprocessor chip is not sufficient. That is a brain, but you need hands and legs or eyes to see and operate. Okay, so those are the interfaces through which, like, microprocessor can talk with the high power mechanical application. Okay, this is a question that I paused on like a few minutes ago. Like, can your computer be connected to any motor directly? What is your response? Yeah, exactly. Small motors, very small, tiny motors you can think of. Even small motors, if you want to drive through your computer, like, you will need something similar to sound card, okay, or you can drive that motor through the sound card. If you connect it directly to your parallel port or serial port, you will destroy it. Okay, so never ever attempt. Okay, this was one of the questions we asked in the exam, like, if one of the DD students connects the motor directly to the computer, what will happen? Like, power requirements on both the sides are totally mismatch. Okay, so you need some device called amplifier in between to do the job and provide the extra power that your application needs. Yeah, okay. So the simplest interface, okay, you might be familiar with is a sound card. Okay, so through sound card, maybe you can drive some speakers which are having low power. If you want to drive like high power speakers, you need some more monitor or some device to take care of that. Okay, so it's exactly same, like the way you are familiar actually with all these concepts, I mean, in your day-to-day life, but I mean you see it from different perspective and it will be useful for your mechatronics application. Okay. This sound card is an interface that you can use. I mean, this is for people who are in the college and they want to make use of CD-ROM, the example that I gave for control. So they can interface the CD-ROM drive with the sound card. I mean, sound card output, instead of going to the speakers, they can drive the coils in the CD head. Okay. And then, like, you have with no cost at all the complete mechatronic application in place. Okay. So digital analog converter is one of the interface. PWM is another interface. Okay, pulse width modulation. Okay, we'll see what is that in a brief. And then digital signals. Okay, digital port, you can have zeros and ones programmable on a digital port and you can use that for driving stepper motor. Then you can have, okay, the more higher ended cards, like data acquisition systems that you get in the market as a product, okay, mainly for the research purposes you can use that, and those may be having some kind of a serial or parallel interface with your computer. Okay, so that RS-232 or some kind of a CAN is another interface for automobile applications. So there are, people have developed a lot of interfaces other than these. I mean, these are most typical kind of interfaces directly for the hardware. But other interfaces are mainly for communication. Okay. So, say for example, if you want to drive a simple servo motor, okay, with maximum current limit 4 amperes, okay, let us say, then this MC33186 is a Motorola chip which you can use for that kind of a application. This is very simple chip which is having this edge bridge configuration, and that can be used for DC servo motor control with PWM. Okay, and when you want to like have, see, stepper motor also you cannot directly connect stepper motor terminals to your digital input output. So that interface or amplifier interface for the stepper motor is this ULN2003 chip. There are a lot of interfaces actually chips available, but these are the things which you can directly start with for building your application. One of the examples. Okay, there are all these issues we are talking about. The other the very important issue is reversing the direction. Okay, we'll see how it is done. What are the solutions? I mean, you just amplifying a signal is not sufficient. Okay, so this direction reversal needs a special treatment or special attention. Okay, especially in the servo motors, not in the stepper motors. Stepper motors, you just change the sequence and it will reverse the direction. But servo motors is that is an issue. Okay. So this power amplification, let us not dwell into. Okay, see, typical transistor characteristics is having like very low. See, it's kind of a dead zone in the near zero. Okay, this voltage versus collector current, amplifier current. Okay, so this kind of a dead zone characteristics is where the problem is. Okay, so you will not be able to drive your motor at very low speeds, so to say. Okay, because of this kind of a characteristics. And you don't have these characteristics on the reverse side. Okay, on the reverse side you don't have these characteristics. Okay, that is another problem. So that's why you cannot reverse the direction. Okay, so what you do is use this pulse width modulation. Okay, you use this pulse kind of a signal. Okay, these are very high frequency pulses which are square type of pulses, and the voltage of this pulse is remaining constant, but the time period is remaining constant, but this on time or called pulse width is what is modulated or changed. Okay, by changing this pulse width you can change the average voltage that is seen by the motor. Okay, so here like these pulses are changing very fast, but motor sees only the average level. Okay, motor doesn't see, because motor cannot respond that fast. These pulses are typically like 10k or 20k kilohertz kind of a frequency. Okay, so you cannot see it changing that fast. It's like a tubelet also there is a fluctuations happening, but our eyes cannot detect those fluctuations. We see that it is as a continuous source of a light. Okay, but those fluctuations which are at higher frequencies we cannot see. Like that these motors, okay, will not be able to see these fluctuations. Okay, so okay, you need to have this point in mind when using PWM for any other applications other than motor. Okay, where say if you are saying like piezoelectric application, I am using PWM. Piezoelectric will respond to this. Okay, this high fluctuation immediately it will respond. But because the response time for piezoelectric is much much smaller. Okay, so you need to be wise in taking decision while using this PWM philosophy for any other application. The basic idea here is that you are not changing the operating point on your transistor characteristics. Okay, the operating point on your transistor characteristics is say for whatever like fixed voltage that you have in the PWM, this fixed voltage. Okay, you are not changing that operating point on your transistor characteristics. Okay, so you are always operating at this point, and so corresponding to that you'll get current. Okay, so you are not at all touching this zone. That is a basics of like using PWM. So you avoid that dead zone by having your operating point fixed. But now how to change the energy, that is, if the operating point is fixed, how to change the energy, like amount of time for which it is on, you reduce or increase. That way it will allow you to change the energy that is going into your motor. Okay, finally what matters for motor to see is average energy that is going into the motor. Okay, so that is how you can build application around this philosophy. And all the components for this kind of a way are easily available in the market. You can program your digital input output ports to generate this PWM, and you can use this 3T186. See, this is a thing which we give in our mechatronics course for students to interface and see themselves. Okay, so this is the most simple way of constructing your own mechatronics system. Okay, then you can have more higher-ended systems built by using more higher-ended drives. Okay, this 33186, that chip is basically edge bridge driver. It works basically on the switching of the transistors. Okay, so this say for example, if you have this out of these four switches, these are transistors. Okay, basically switching is done by the transistor. Okay, so these transistors S1 and S4, when they are switched on, the motor will go in one direction, and when they are open and S2 and S3 are switched on, motor will reverse the direction. Okay, so it's basically the reversal is done by using transistor switching. Okay, in the edge bridge, and edge bridge chip has that. Everything is there on the chip to take care of your direction reversal. You need to give appropriate signals to the pins of the chip, and then it will. There is a pin on which if you give 0, if you give 1, it will change the direction. Okay, so that is how in edge bridge, that 3T186 chip, it will happen. But if you go to internally, what is happening is this is what is happening internally into the chip. Okay, if you want to have specified accuracy and range, how that specifications affect selection of actuator. Okay, so say for example, for 1 micrometer, you cannot use anything which gives you the friction. Okay, so basically friction is a very killing factor in very high precision applications. Okay, so you need to avoid friction and backlash. These are the two things to be avoided if you are going for 1 micron kind of a precision. Okay, so in that case, what is done is basically if you want to have a motion, you use some kind of a cantilever to which your stage is suspended, and you keep it in the magnetic field. Okay, so as you change the magnetic field, this cantilever will bend, and there is no friction happening anywhere. Okay, you get this point? So it's a simple philosophy of flexures. Okay, this is called flexure. Okay, flexure mechanism or flexure joint you can use, and you can have reproducibly same thing. Exactly at the same position it will stop when your voltage is at the same point. Okay, so that is a precision that you will get because there is no friction. If there is a friction, next time you cannot predict that at that point the same amount of frictional force will be there. Okay, because of the wear, the surface might have changed its characteristics, and it would have changed the friction force. So high precision positioning will not be possible with the friction. Okay, so that is the main point of this example. Okay,
so how that flexural forces are generated, how that flexural force, it has to flex, no?
You are applying magnetic field. You need to have the magnetic coils or permanent magnet and magnetic coil, and you can that magnetic force you apply at the end, and then flex this thing will have to bend, right? When you apply force on the cantilever, it will bend. So that is how the force is generated. Okay, Okay, the sensor interfaces are essentially the same. Like you in addition to the digital and AD, I mean analog to digital converter, you have encoder interface which you don't have for actuators. Okay, so that is a additional interface. Again, that has something to do with the way the I showed you in encoder. So whatever zeros and one coming out of that encoder need to be processed in proper way to say that okay, this is one count, this is another count, like that. How is it happening is a little complicated thing, but how to use that is very simple. Okay, so you need to have a balanced understanding. Okay, you need not be knowing everything that okay, how is it happening. You may be in specialized in whatever your field, okay. So you may not know details about okay how microprocessor is working, okay, or how flip flops and other things are changing to make the microprocessor work. I mean that is not a not your field of specialization. You need not know that, but how to use microprocessor, that is for sure you should know. Okay, so some of the things you may be knowing, may not be knowing, doesn't matter. But like okay, it's important to know. What are the things which are important to know? Okay, so that as long as you think about and like make the sense of okay, what is important to know, and then you are fine. Okay, so it's not like your skill in a particular area that will help you, but it's a thing. Okay, what is important to know for this application to work with a high performance, with a lower cost. What is important to know? As long as you are making that kind of a decision, okay, this is not sufficient, I need to know more about this to get this thing. That is a kind of a feel that if you are getting for the application, that will work best. Okay, doesn't matter what expertise you have. Okay, you just need to have that kind of a that kind of a understanding. I mean, it will come through. I mean, most of you have that actually, and you just need to be aware and enhance that. Okay, and it will come through as you go along and consciously be aware. Okay, am I taking right decision? I'm not taking. All those things, it will slowly start developing. Okay, just being aware about that kind of a faculty, it will get developed. Okay, this is the rig that I was talking about. So these are the actuators. Okay, this is a motor. There is an encoder on this motor at the back, and then there is a ball screw which is hidden under this paper, which is used for like preventing dust to enter there, which is moving this linear stage, which is placed on the linear bearings. Okay, and this is a mechanism which will be giving the tank a rotary motion. Okay, and here again there is this linear slide. You can see that there is a stage which is moving in the linear direction as this rotary excitation motor rotates, which is again having this encoder. Okay, this has a big amplifier attached to this motor, and then from that amplifier we are taking the signals into computer. Okay, so are giving the signal from computer to this amplifier, and then that is driving this motor. Okay, so I'll show you this video. You can see I'm not able to point out because it's showing in some different monitor. On this monitor it is not seen, but you can see how the linear slide is moving, and along with that also the linear the pitching actuation motor is also working on at the same time. And if you see at a liquid level closely, it's not changing at all. Okay, so this is what we are doing actually, is we are giving one motion to the linear degree of freedom, linear translation. We are giving some motion, and we are adjusting the other motion such that the slosh is compensated. Okay, so this, it is possible to do that. Okay, so So this is a demonstration actually of slosh cancellation. Okay. I mean, this is not really a feedback kind of a control. Okay. We have developed a couple of feedback control strategies also on these. Actually, at the base of this tank, if you notice carefully, you will find that load cell. Okay. No, it is hidden here. Okay. This is a wire that you see for the load cell. Okay. So we have the load cell which is at the base of the tank, which is capturing the forces and moments in all six, whatever, like three forces and three moments we are capturing. Okay. And because of the sloshing, whatever these moments and forces are generated, they are getting recorded, and that is can be used now for like, okay, identifying my pendulum parameters, identifying different, proposing different models. Okay. So those that data can be processed further to like get the meaningful information out of the system. I mean, this is a project from ISRO. You know, in launch vehicles that go in the space, there are like lot of fuel they carry. Okay, the 70% of the weight that goes in the space is liquid. So the liquid motion has lot of effect on your trajectory. I mean, for this Saturn trajectory, I mean Saturn failure was because of the slosh. These forces were not characterized before, and because of that, like the controller that they had developed was not sufficient to like take care of this, and because of that there was a Saturn failure. So slosh is very important for space rockets. Okay. So ISRO has like given this project to us to develop this rig and like develop different models and model parameters, schemes, algorithms for the space application. Okay, now this technology has been transferred to them, and they are also now developing on a bigger size. This is like a 10 kg tank, but they are developing on a bigger size, like a 50 kg or 100 kg tank to carry out their experiments. And they'll be all using our control algorithms to really identify various parameters. Okay, so that is a practical example. So in conclusion, like the automation engineer needs to have good knowledge about these elements, okay, sensors, actuator, and their interfacing to really synthesize your mechanical system. Okay, all right.